In this lecture, we are going to see the session hijacking. Session hijacking is a most commonly performing attack on the web applications. The session is, in the sense, an active connection that is established legitimately between the client and server. This session hijacking is the most frequent happening on the internet. Whenever the customers or the clients are using the web applications of a particular server for performing the financial transactions or any commercial transactions over the internet. Now we'll see this particular session hijacking concept. In this lecture, we'll see the theoretical aspects of the session hijacking. In the later lectures, we'll see the practical aspects of the session hijacking. Session hijacking is the process of taking over the legitimately established active connection between the client and server. So here we need to observe the terminology that is used in the definition. Session hijacking is the process of taking over the legitimately established. So what is here legitimately established? Legitimately, in the sense, the client properly uses his authentication mechanism or validates the authentication mechanism by entering the valid username and password, and the server will also accept that username and password, and then the connection is established. This process is said to be legitimate establishing of the connection. So legitimately established active connection. So here active connection means this is not a logout connection, this is an ongoing connection between the client and server. You may think of that, how is it possible? So this is possible in various ways in the process of session hijacking. It can be done at two levels of the protocol stack that we will discuss afterwards. An example is like this. There is a user and server. User will send the connection request via username and password that he enters and will send to the server. Server in turn will check the username and password and will send back the session or establish the session and will communicate with the user. The indication of the establishing of the session is the server will generate a session ID. Later on, during the particular connection, the user has to use the same session ID to communicate with the server. Then the server will keep a registry or register at its end to maintain what are the connections that are actively established with the server and their session IDs. And along with the session IDs, it will also maintain the time login and time lost active. This information will be maintained at the server. Time login is the login time, and the last active is the when recently the user is interacted with the server. If the last active is the difference between the last active and the login time exceeds some pre-specified time, then the session will be automatically closed by the server. This is called automatic session timeout. It is just like you may log in into the internet banking systems, and if you are inactive and not using the internet banking application for at least 5 minutes, then automatically the session will be logged out. So how this particular session will be logged out? This will be done at the server end, that the valid session ID that is generated will be deleted by the session server, so that the client cannot communicate with the server. The reason is the client has to always use the valid session ID to connect with the server or to get any services from the server. But if the server itself deleted the session ID that was created, then that server will not receive the request, even though it receives, as the reason is the user is not communicating with the valid session ID. So this is what is called automatic session logout. So whenever this legitimate connection is established, the attacker is one who is trying to hijack this particular session. As user is using the web application, this particular hijacking can be done at the application level, that is via web applications. That means via the protocols that are used at the web application, such as HTTP or FTP. Anyhow, HTTP or FTP and the protocols that are used at the application layer are not independent or autonomous to directly communicate with the end application having the HTTP or FTP. For that, the application layer protocols must internally use the next level protocols, such as transport layer protocols. The transport layer protocols are TCP and UDP. So HTTP or FTP must take the services of the FTP or UDP. And HTTP and FTP will give the request to the TCP or UDP and will take the services from the TCP or UDP at the receiver end. So that is the reason these two are the soft targets for the attacker. So this session hijacking can be done actively or passively via these two layers, that is by targeting the application layer or via transport layer. That means mainly focused on the TCP or UDP or at the application layer protocols. So this is what the hijacking activity will be done. Hijacking means here the active connection is going on, but the attacker will use some technique at the application layer or at the transport layer to take hold of the user's session. And whenever this particular user session takeover is successful, then attacker will communicate with the server as the user is communicating with the server. This is what is called session hijacking means. For this, again, the core of entire hacking process after the physical data link and network layer is the transport layer. Many of the hacking activities, especially application level hacking activities, are purely based on the transport layer protocol, in which majority of the applications depending on the TCP protocol. For that, you are supposed to understand TCP three-way handshake thoroughly. Anyhow, I have provided the video on the TCP three-way handshake previously. You may refer that video, or you may go through any of the standard computer networks textbook, or you may go through the TCP IP protocol stack by B.A. Forosen or by Tenenbaum. So you may refer any of this standard textbook and you may come to know the TCP three-way handshake is. What is TCP three-way handshake is? Because you must thoroughly know, or you must be in a position to remember thoroughly, even in sleep also. If I wake up you and ask you, what is TCP three-way handshake and what is the TCP packet structure and what are the different flags available in that, you must be in a position to say. If you might have thorough with these three things, for example, that these three things means here, one is TCP packet structure and communication. Second one is UDP packet structure and communication. Third one is ICMP packet structure and communication. If you are be thorough with these three things, I can assure you that you are 70% expert in the area of the penetration testing or ethical hacking. Because 70% of the attacks, 70 to 75% of the attacks are mainly focused on these three protocols. Next is, as I told you just now, unless until there is no valid session ID or valid session token, sometimes this ID is also called as token, unless until there is no valid session ID or session token, the server will not provide any services, or user cannot communicate with any the server. So that is the reason session ID plays a major role in managing the sessions. That means the entire key point or key objective of the hacker in the session hijacking is capturing of the session ID. If you can get the session ID, then your work is done. So that is the reason I have given this detailed description. The entire scenario, in the total scenario of the session establishment and communication, the critical thing that will play a major role is session ID. Always the attacker will target the session ID to capture. So once he is successful in capturing the session ID, that most of his work was done. So session hijacking can be done actively or passively. The active way of connectivity or active way of attacking is done with the help of transport layer protocols. That is either via TCP or UDP. Whereas in the case of passive attacks or passive session hijacking, usually in which the attacker will not directly involve in the communication. However, he will pretend himself as a normal user and will intercept the communication channel and may go for the monitoring or sniffing of the traffic that is happening between the target systems. So he may use any powerful sniffing tools like Wireshark or TCP dump that we have discussed, that you have studied previously. The same concept may be used here to gain the traffic, and with the traffic that he gained, he may go for analyzing of the traffic, and in which he may identify the packet sequence numbers, session numbers or session IDs, etc. And he may go for predicting of his own session ID, or the may fabricate a session ID, or he may go for guessing of what would be the session ID. So this is a analysis process that was done, that will be done with the help of the traffic that he, the attacker sniffed on the communication channel. So three primary techniques used to do the session hijacking are, first one is brute forcing and session ID. Here brute forcing means it is done by guessing. That means the attacker, if he is an expert attacker, he may go for guessing of the session ID by looking at the traffic. So for that, attacker may use HTTP referrers, sniffing, cross-site scripting, or malwares. So previously we have in the syllabus we have seen the malwares concept. They may use malwares, the cross-site scripting, sniffing, or HTTP referrers. Any one of these can be used to brute force the session ID, and especially to predict the session ID. Second one is stealing an ID. Stealing an ID is usually done by the sniffing process. So in order to go for sniffing, to steal the session ID, especially the attacker must use a powerful sniffer in general. Otherwise, capturing the session ID is somewhat difficult. Okay. Next, finally, is calculating an ID. So how one can calculate an ID? So calculating ID is an expert level. Usually the attacker calculates the ID by observing the sequence number patterns. So whatever the sequence number patterns going on the traffic, he may go for predicting the session IDs based on the pattern it may go. Basically, the machine learning techniques or the statistical techniques that what we use for performing the prediction in the general machine learning projects that what we have done so far, the same concepts can also be used for predicting the session ID. Is nothing but actually you are supposed to use some intelligent technique to predict the pattern That means you are supposed to discover the pattern and you need to predict the pattern. Then you need to go for the calculating of the session ID. So this is what the actually thing is. So here some intelligent tools like machine learning techniques or machine learning methods or deep learning methods may also be used in order to predict the session IDs. So this way of doing is, there is a big research area in this particular aspect, which is called as adversarial machine learning. So this is the concept in the computer network and security, where the machine learning can be actively used for making the predictions of the ongoing traffic and also to detect the adversaries. Adversary means the attacker. So adversaries, so this particular area is a very broad area and also widely used and attracted by the academia and research. So if you are interested to do that, then you may choose the adversarial machine learning. You may make note of this and may are getting of the documentation related to the adversarial machine learning. A lot of documentation is available over the Google search engine. So what is the root cause of this session hijacking or session hacking? The root cause of this session hijacking or hacking is the following lapses in the application may lead to the session hijacking. What are the lapses? So far, we might have built some web applications with the front end as PHP or maybe any other popular tools, popular programming, but back end as some MySQL or something. But have you ever checked these following things in the web application that you have developed? First one is no account lockout for invalid session IDs. Have you provided a systematic logout mechanism? Whenever you go for login, have you gone for a systematic providing of the systematic logout mechanism? If there is no systematic logout mechanism, then that particular web application session may lead to session hijacking. The logout session means, in the sense, whenever the logout is clicked by the user, then you may ask the user to go for whether he is really going for the logout or not. If still he is want to go for logout, then whatever the session ID, whatever the session information that is generated and stored in the browser must be deleted. So once it is deleted, then it must display the logout screen. And if you want to log in again, he has to do that the communication from the beginning. That is, he has to enter the legitimate username and password and need to enter again. It is just not like that. If the back page is pressed, directly he is going and entering into the session. If this kind of thing was happened, then session hijacking is very easy to perform. Next one is insecure handling. There is no security in session. So security must be provided in the session. That may be provided with the help of encryption or any other mechanism. Next one is weak session ID generation algorithm. Session IDs should not be predictable. Session IDs must be completely random. Session ID, in the sense, some number or mixture of numbers and characters, something will be generated. Basically, this generation of the session IDs should be completely random. They should not be predictable. So whenever the randomness is there, then you cannot predict via some intelligent algorithms. That is what the general idea of this weak session ID generation algorithms, if it is used or used, then predicting the session ID is very easy. Next one is indefinite session expiration time. There should be some fixed time expiration time should be there. That means if the inactivity persists for at least 5 minutes, then the logout should be done automatically. So some standard or some fixed expiration time must be there. Next one is clear text transmission. Here I have written as test. It is clear text transmission. Clear text transmission means the transmission of the data must not be in the plain text. However, some encryption mechanism must be used to transmit the data, so that the communication, if the attacker sits and and sniff the packets or sniff the transmission channel, then he should not be in a position to get any information related to the text. So that is the reason clear text transmission will also lead to the session hijacking. In WhatsApp and some other communication channels or in the chat communication, you may find end-to-end encryption is enabled, or this particular the user has gone for the security change. So this kind of messages you might have seen during the WhatsApp communications and all. That what is the meaning of this is the communication that is happening between you and your friend will be encrypted during the transmission, and again that will be decrypted at the end. So this is what the encrypted transmission. Even though the session, anyone who is sitting on the communication channel and sniff the communication may not get the information related to the what actual information that you are transmitting between you and your friend. Next one is small session IDs. Small session IDs can be predictable and can be tried via guessing the session IDs. So you are always supposed to use long session IDs. So the solution is always use encrypted sessions with a long session ID. Always you use long, very long session IDs, maybe of 256 bits length, or maybe very long session IDs. And at the same time, whatever the session ID that you generate and the communication that you perform between the server and client must be in an encrypted form. So this usually will be followed by the HTTPS at the application layer. So HTTPS means Hypertext Transfer Protocol plus Secure Socket Layer. These two have been used, and this HTTPS was proposed. Whenever you use HTTPS, it is somewhat difficult to gain the session hijacking or to get the successful session hijacking. Majority of the session hijacking can be easily done on the HTTP based web applications. So what is meant by hijacking and spoofing? So how this particular spoofing is different from hijacking? Spoofing may be a part of the hijacking, but spoofing is not the hijacking. This is what you are supposed to understand. In spoofing, attacker does not take over any session. It is usually the attacker is pretended to be a system or user and will try to observe the pattern of the traffic that is going on the communication channel. But in case of hijacking, the attacker take over the active session. So how he will take over the active sessions? It can be done at the two layers. One is at the application layer, or maybe via the transport layer. So we'll see afterwards how it can be done via application layer and via transport layer. The process of session hijacking looks as follows. The first step is always like this. The attacker who is sitting on the at one another place will always try to observe the or will try to capture the traffic pattern or traffic that is happening between the target systems. Especially he will look for the connection establishment. He may be knowing the IP address of the client and he may be knowing the IP address of the server. Via capturing the traffic, he will observe whether the connection is established or not. How you can say the connection is established? Via TCP three-way handshake. Whenever the synchronous signal was sent by the client, the server will send back the synchronous acknowledgement signal. In response to the synchronous acknowledgement signal, the client will send the ACK signal to establish the connection. So whenever this three-way handshake is completed, the user, the attacker will come to know that the connection is established between the client and server. Then whatever the traffic that will be generated between the client and server IP addresses thereafter will be seriously captured and observed. So the second step, it will go for monitoring. Observe after connection establishment was confirmed, then observing the traffic for session IDs and packet sequence numbers between the targets. Because if the TCP, in the TCP communication, every packet is labeled with some sequence number. So via sequence numbers, you can predict you can predict or you can fabricate some new packets and may inject into the communication channel by keeping the same source ID as or source IP as the target victim, or we can say the client's IP address and the destination IP as the server's IP address. And these packets may be fabricated, can be injected into the communication channel via predicting this particular sequence number. For example, the client has sent a packet with a sequence number 1234. Then that means the attacker cannot use the sequence number below this 1234, because the packets with sequence number which are below 1234 might have already taken by the server. So he may send the immediate sequence number, immediate packet with the immediate sequence number. Okay, or he may observe the packets that are reported lost by the server. Whenever the server reported loss of packet in TCP communication, in general, what will happen? The retransmission of the same packet takes place. That is, the retransmission of the lost packet will take place. Whenever this lost packet has to be transmitted, the attacker may fabricate that packet with the sequence number that was lost and may inject into the communication channel. So this is the way how actively he may inject the packets into the communication channel, which is a kind of active session hijacking. Next one is session desynchronization. The step 3 is session desynchronization, in which breaking the session between the targets. How he can break the session between the targets? Like this. First, he observes the sequence number. He may fabricate a new packet. For example, if he fabricate a new packet, as that the packet is generated by the targeted client, that means the attacker may enter the target client's IP address in this, and destination IP as the server IP, and he may set a RST signal. We can say in the TCP flags there is a signal called RST signal. If he set the RST signal as 1 and he sends the packet, automatically server will feel that the client is going to reset the connection. The client is going to reset the connection, and whenever the next connection request has come, then only the connection has to be established. In this time, the attacker may send a packet as a synchronous signal by naming or by quoting the target's IP address, that is the client's IP address. Then the connection may be established between the attacker and server, as server is thinking that the real client is going to connect with the server. So this way of interception will be done by the attacker once he came to know, or he can predict the sequence numbers of the packets. So that is the reason session desynchronization, breaking sessions between the targets, that will be done like this at the transport layer with the help of transport layer protocol, that is called TCP. So that is the reason to understand this transport layer session hijacking concept, one must thoroughly know the TCP three-way handshake. Next one is session ID prediction, predicting the session ID and taking over the session. Next one is command injection. The command injection, in the sense, he may inject a new packet, or he may fabricate the packet and may be injected, or he may use once the attacker gone for the application level hijacking, and he may inject the commands of whatever he wants via HTTP post request or maybe HTTP get request. Because if you want to communicate with the server with the help of web application, obviously the web application will use either get request or post request. So that means either get command may be used or post command may be used to inject the commands onto the communication. And this injection may also, or it may be of SQL injection. So the session hijacking and predicting the session ID and URLs is the one key part of the SQL injection, SQL injection also. So that means this session hijacking is a very broad aspect that can be covered with the web applications hijacking, web applications hacking, or SQL injection, or cross-site scripting, or man in the middle. So many things that will be involved in this particular session hijacking. So session hijacking can be done at two layers of the protocol stack, as just now we have discussed it, at transport layer, that is either via using TCP or UDP, or application layer via HTTP, FTP, etc. But if you use HTTPS at the level of at the application layer, it is somewhat difficult for the attacker to perform the session hijacking, as you are using the secured socket layer where encryption is possible, and the data encryption is possible, and session ID encryptions are also possible. So that is somewhat difficult task for the attacker to perform. So that is the reason always it is recommended to use HTTPS sites where on the browser you will find it is secure. That means valid SSL certificate is available with that user or with that particular server. Such websites you must be used for this purpose, for performing the financial transactions, especially like internet banking and any other e-commerce websites where you are supposed to submit your the debit card or credit card details. So there you are supposed to observe, first of all, the first check you are supposed to do is on the browser at the immediately just left of the URL, you have to find that whether it is secured or unsecured. If the site is unsecured, be very cautious. Don't give any personal data or personal information in that. That personal information may be captured at any place by the attacker. So you must be keep it in mind for the proceeding into the web application or internet banking or electronic commerce applications. It might be any other applications that you use, especially where you are going to submit the sensitive data or sensitive information. Hope by this time you come to know the what is meant by session hijacking. Now we'll see session hijacking and web applications. Session hijacking at application layer aims to gain access to a system by getting the session ID from the victim. Usually, if you want to view your own session ID on a Google Chrome browser or Mozilla Firefox, enter any website by entering your valid username and password, login into any website. Then after login, go to the settings and you go to the developer's mode. In the developer's mode, you will find the code related to the ongoing session will be, you may find it. In that, you will find various tags. You will find various tags and metadata in that particular thing. There, you will find the session ID. In the next lecture, I will show you how to identify the session ID once you establish the connection between the establish the connection with the server. So this is the way you can get the session ID. That means at your end, you can view the session ID. What is the session ID? The purpose of session ID is in three flavors. The reason is if the client has to communicate with the server and to get the services from the server, the client should always use his own session ID, because it's just like for example, you have been allotted a enrollment number. If you want to communicate with any administrative procedure or any admission procedure at a university, you are supposed to use the roll number, enrollment number. That is a valid enrollment number. By looking at the enrollment number, the university administration will come to know that you are a valid student or not. Valid student means there is a 4 years of degree. Within the 4 years, you are available or not. So this is just like that. So since this particular session ID usually will be communicated with the server in various forms, how First one is embedded in URLs. Without knowing to you, the session ID may be sometimes embedded in the URL. Attacker can browse through the browsing history of the web application, use HTTP GET command. I told you GET command and general HTTP are so much vulnerable. So HTTP GET command to obtain the data. This is one way where you can find the session ID in the embedded URLs. Next one is embedded as hidden field. For example, you are filling a form that was displayed by the server, and the server wants to get who has filled that particular form. Internally, there is a hidden field will be there where automatically your session ID will be included in that. But when the attacker is trying to sniff the communication over the communication channel, obviously during the sniffing, along with the data that you have submitted in the form, he may also get the session ID that is hidden in the form data that was transmitting on the communication channel. Embedded as hidden field, many form pages consists of the session ID as hidden field, and same ID will be sent via HTTP POST command. The third one is cookies. Cookies are the small text that resides on the client desk. Especially the cookies are used to not send entire data again and again to the server. Instead, the critical information, the key information or key data will be stored on the client desk itself. Usually, whenever the logout perfect, or there is regular logout was performed, these cookies should also be closed. Or whenever you try to close the browser, the cookies should be deleted automatically. For that, in the browser, you may find the settings. In the settings, you can go for this deleting of the cookies whenever the browser is closed. Otherwise, what will happen? These cookies will become the soft target for the attacker. And he may get the information from the cookies. But how this particular cookies information can be obtained by the attacker, since they are not transmitting over the communication channel? No problem. That may be captured by the attackers via cross-site scripting or via tempting you to install malicious add-ons or tempting you to click on malicious URLs. In any of these forms, the attacker may get the cookies information to his end. So cookies are the small text that resides on the client desk. They consist of frequently used content, and it may be the soft target for the attackers whenever they go for application level scripting, such as injecting of the malware, use of the JavaScript, malicious JavaScript, or cross-site scripting, or tempting you to click the malicious URLs or malicious advertisements or malicious add-ons to your browser. So these are the ways in which the session ID can be obtained by the attacker at the application level. So that's all for this lecture, and we'll see some more concepts, especially related to the web application hijacking and transport level protocols for session hijacking in the next lecture, along with some practical aspects.